वेलकम स्टूडेंट्स, आवर टुडेज लेक्चर इज़ द कंटिन्यूएशन ऑफ आवर प्रीवियस लेक्चर द प्रोटीन प्रोटीन इंटरेक्शंस। टुडे वी विल टेक अप द प्रोटीन माइक्रोएरे टेक्नोलॉजी। सो बिफोर गोइंग इनटू द डिटेल ऑफ द टॉपिक, वी हैव टू फर्स्ट अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज़ द सेंट्रल डॉगमा ऑफ द सेल। So, in central dogma of the cell, a gene generally expresses via different processes. The formation of mRNA is called the transcription, and the formation of the proteins from mRNA is called the translation. So, in this way, a gene expresses itself. But how much a gene will express, it depends upon the some internal and external parameters like the aging, what is the age of the cell, or what are the environmental conditions. So how much it will express, it depends upon the certain conditions. So how can we measure the gene expression under these different states of the cell? So there are several methods already available for the gene expression. These involve the northern blotting, then RT-PCR, etc. So recently, the microarray technology can also be applied to monitor these intracellular gene and protein expression mechanism. So DNA microarrays, these are generally used for the genetic analysis, like analysis of the mutation in the gene or the single nucleotide polymorphism, as well as these are used for the expression analysis at the mRNA level. But there is no absolute correlation between mRNA level and the corresponding protein level. So we can measure the gene expression using the mRNA level, but by using the mRNA we cannot exactly determine the protein expression level or the concentration of protein in the cell, because protein functionality is dependent upon certain post-translational processing of the precursor protein. Okay, because once the protein has been formed from the mRNA, it undergoes several changes, which we termed as the post-translational modifications. And a single mRNA, by the process of alternative splicing, may give rise to different kinds of protein. So there is always debate on this, the correlation between mRNA and proteins. And second thing is that the regulation of the cellular pathways frequently occur in specific interaction between the proteins or by several covalent modifications like the phosphorylation. So to obtain the detailed information about a complex biological system, information on the state of many protein is required. And the analysis of the proteome of a cell is not possible without high throughput protein analysis, which could be carried out by the protein microarray technology. Okay. So DNA microarray is used for the expression analysis using the mRNA, and protein microarray, it is generally used to study the concentration of protein in the cell, as well as used to study the post-translational modification independent of the mRNA level. So as our topic is protein-protein interaction, so there is a little bit description on this which in detail we have studied in our previous lecture. So protein-protein interactions are generally the physical interaction between two or more proteins as a result of certain biochemical events. So these interactions generally involves different types of electrostatic forces, hydrophobic effects, or some kind of covalent interactions. And these protein-protein interaction leads to the formation of a protein network, which is very much important to carry out the molecular processes in the cell. So several processes like signal transduction, then transport across membranes, then the muscle contraction, and the cell metabolism, all are dependent upon these protein-protein interactions. Any disorder in this interaction, it will lead to certain fatal diseases like Alzheimer's. So how the protein microarray technologies carried out, or what is the protein microarray or the protein chip? So basic principle of this microarray technology was given by Roger Akins and colleagues in 1989 based on their ambient analyte theory. So Akins and the colleagues, they were able to quantify the femtomolar concentration of an analyte, that is thyroid stimulating hormone, TSH hormone, okay, using the microarray method. Okay, so based on their analyte theory, ambient analyte theory, they show that the miniaturized ligand binding assay are able to achieve a superior sensitivity. Means a system that uses small amount of sample, or you can say analyte, and small amount of capture molecule can be more sensitive than a system that uses 100 times more material under the ambient condition. Okay, so means that if we use a highly purified and small amount of analyte for detection using a particular capture molecule, the sensitivity of the ऐसे गेट्स इंक्रीज्ड 100 टाइम्स देन द ऐसे कैरिड आउट यूजिंग द मोर अमाउंट ऑफ एनालाइट. ओके सो दिस एम्बिएंट एनालाइट थ्योरी फर्स्ट लेड टू द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ डीएनए माइक्रो एरे एंड लेटर ऑन ड्यू टू सम लिमिटेशन इन द यूज ऑफ डीएनए माइक्रो एरे फॉर प्रोटीन क्वांटिफिकेशन इट लेड्स टू द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ प्रोटीन माइक्रो एरे टेक्नोलॉजी. सो दिस प्रोटीन माइक्रो एरे टेक्नोलॉजी और प्रोटीन माइक्रो एरे सिंपली इज ऑल्सो नोन एज द प्रोटीन चिप टेक्नोलॉजी और द प्रोटीन चिप. सो प्रोटीन चिप, वट इज द प्रोटीन चिप? सो इट इज द मिनिएचराइजेशन ऑफ थाउजेंड्स ऑफ पैरेलल ऐसे ऑन वेरी स्मॉल प्लेट और द सबस्ट्रेटा एम्बेडेड विद स्मॉल अमाउंट ऑफ प्यूरिफाइड प्रोटीन्स इन ए हाईली इन हाई डेंसिटी फॉर्मेट. बेसिकली चिप क्या है? चिप इज ए स्मॉल सॉलिड सरफेस ऑन विच ए वेरी स्मॉल अमाउंट ऑफ प्यूरिफाइड एनालाइट प्यूरिफाइड प्रोटीन्स विच कैन बी एंटीजन विच कैन बी एंटीबॉडी इन ए हाई डेंसिटी आर एम्बेडेड. ओके एंड दिस मेथड इज यूज टू स्टडी द प्रोटीन प्रोटीन इंट्रैक्शंस एंड देयर फंक्शनल एस्पेक्ट्स. एंड दिस प्रोटीन माइक्रो एरे टेक्नोलॉजी कैन कंप्लीमेंट अदर टेक्निक्स सच एज मास स्पेक्ट्रोमीट्री एंड यीस्ट टू हाइब्रिड एसेज टू आइडेंटिफाई thousand of protein-protein interactions. So how the microarrays are produced? So the microarrays are produced or chip is prepared by immobilizing protein on the microscopic solid surface and mainly the glass is used, glass slides are mainly used, but some plastic and polymer membranes can also be used. So the proteins, purified proteins, or you can say antigens or antibodies, they can be attached to the solid surface either by the covalent or by the specific bimolecular interactions. Okay, so first the surface of the slide needs to be chemically activated using aldehyde or some epoxides so that a covalent interaction can be carried out between protein and the substrate, or it can be coated with the nickel. Then the bimolecular interaction between the protein and the substrate can be carried out using polyhistidine tag and the nickel chelation. And what are the methods of immobilizing? Generally, the immobilization is carried out by the contact microarray method or the non-contact microarray methods. So, in contact microarray method, which is known as the robotic method, the needle which is used to load the purified proteins on the substrate comes in the direct contact with the substrate. A needle is generally filled with these highly purified proteins and then with the help of machines it come in contact with the substrate and load the material directly on it. But in non-contact microarray method like ink jetting method, the material is filled into the miniature hole which is known as the jet. It is also containing piezoelectric material. So when current is passed through this hole, the liquid which is generally our material get fall onto the substrate. Okay, so there is no direct contact between the arrayers or the loader with the substrate. So what is the working principle of this protein microarray technology? So in this technology, generally the samples, different protein samples are taken out from two cells. They are extracted and then labeled with the different fluorophore. So fluorophores are the chemicals which emit light when these get excited with the laser beam. Okay, so different fluorophores have different absorption and the emission spectra. So generally the Psi 5 and Psi 3 labels are used. So after labeling, both the samples, they are mixed and hybridized to the same microarray. So specific capture molecule, so here you can say this is the capture molecule, means which has been fixed on the surface. Specific capture molecule on the solid surface then interact with their respective target protein, and the resulting signal intensity of two differentially labeled target on each microspore directly reveal the concentration of each in the sample. How much signals are generated at each spot of a particular analyte? More the intensity, more the concentration. Less the intensity, less will be the concentration. So there are two types of the protein microarray based on the functionality, how these are carried out to detect the different kind of analytes in the sample. So broadly these are divided into forward phase protein microarray or the reverse phase protein microarray. The forward phase are further of two type: functional protein microarray and the analytical protein microarray. We will deal in detail in next slides. So first is the analytical protein microarrays. So this array is the multiplex format of the original ELISA technique. It is also known as the antibody microarray, which is a kind of sandwich immunoassay. So this sandwich immunoassay, as the name clear, the antigen is sandwiched between two antibodies. Okay. And this sandwich assay generally provides the higher sensitivity for detecting the analyte. Okay. So in this technique, we need two type of highly purified antibodies. One is the capture antibody used to bind the target protein or the protein of interest. And second antibody is the detection or reporter antibody having the signaling label. Like this is Psi-5 or Psi-3 dyes. So these capture antibodies are immobilized on the solid surface. And after binding, the multivalent antigen or the cell lysate is poured over this microarray. So multivalent antigen is that antigen which contain more than one type of the epitope. And epitope is the antigenic determinant, okay, part of the antigen. It bind with the paratope, part of the antibody, okay. So once the antigen has bind to this capture antibody, the detection antibody with the signaling molecule is poured and it binds to this multivalent antigen. Okay. So then it is excited with the help of a laser beam, and the signals are detected by the confocal cameras or by the fluorescent microscopes. But there are certain limitations of this microarray. One is that the many antibodies may cross react. There are the chances of cross reactivity. So many antibodies may cross react with the protein other than their expected target proteins when tested for multiple analytes at the same time. And this may lead to the false positive results. So the production of highly specific antibodies that are able to identify the protein of interest with high specificity and affinity always remained the problem. So, however, the certain advanced method of antibody, monoclonal antibody production, like phage antibody display, has led to the more promising result, but yet the high throughput method is under the development. Okay, so this analytical protein array can be used to monitor the protein expression levels or biomarker identification and the environment or the food safety analysis. The another kind of microarray is the functional protein microarray, which is also known as the target protein array. It is different from analytical protein microarray in term of containing the full length functional protein or protein domains on the substrate. In this case, the proteins which are attached to the substrate should not lose its three-dimensional structure. Why it should not lose? Because to study the functional interactions between two proteins, a functional protein in three-dimensional form in its tertiary structure must be attached to the substrate. Another difference is that in analytical protein microarray, we use the antibodies for binding to the substrate. Here, the purified recombinant proteins are immobilized on the solid surface. And this functional protein microarray has been used to study the protein-protein interactions, protein-lipid interactions, protein-DNA interactions, then protein-small molecule interaction, then kinase to study the kinase activities, and for profiling the immune response. So there are several studies or the examples of these kind of interactions. So Zhu et al. In 2001, they were the first to use the yeast proteome chip to find out the protein-protein interactions. Okay, they were able to find out the partner of the calmodulin protein in yeast. So this is the calcium binding protein. In addition, the scientists, they also identified the various phospholipids which are known to act as secondary messenger using this microarray, protein microarray technology. Hall et al. In 2004, using the yeast proteome chips, they were able to find out 200 DNA binding proteins in the yeast with the most important arginine 5-6 DNA binding protein. The gene ARG5-6, it is very important in producing the two enzymes which are useful in the generation of the ornithine in the yeast. Similarly, this yeast proteome chip was also probed to identify the target proteins for the drug rapamycin by Huang and co-worker in 2004. And the third type of protein microarray is the reverse phase protein microarray. How it is different from forward phase protein microarray? Whereas in forward phase microarray, the antibodies are designed to be fixed over the substrate, okay. And in reverse phase protein microarray, generally the cell lysates are arranged to the microarray, okay. And these are probed with the antibodies against a target protein. This is the difference, okay. Capture antibody on the substrate, antigens on the substrate. Here the complete cell lysate is probed. Here the antibodies are used as probe. So this microarray was first used by the Pavlez and colleague to monitor the histological changes in the prostate cancer. So using the proteins from the different stages of the cancers, they were able to identify the different stages of the prostate cancer. Because whenever there is the alteration in the protein in the disease cell, that will indicate the different physiological state of the cell, and that can be detected using those altered proteins. And for post-translational modification, this reverse phase protein microarray technique can also be used. So in broad term, these microarray techniques are used in the five major fields of diagnostic, proteomics, protein functional analysis, antibody characterization, and the treatment development. In diagnostic, generally it involves the detection of antigens and antibodies in blood sample, or monitoring the disease state, or monitoring the environment and the food samples. And proteomics, it pertains to the protein expression profile, means which protein are expressed in the lysate of a cell. And the protein functional analysis, it involves the identification of protein-protein interactions, protein phospholipid, protein-drug interactions, and the identification of the substrate for a particular enzyme like kinase. Then antibody characterization, generally it involves the cross reactivity, specificity, and mapping of the epitope. And the treatment development means the development of the antigen specific therapy for allergy or cancer, also the identification of the target for development of new drugs. So this is all about the protein microarray techniques. Hope you must have gained some basic idea of this technology. Thanks.